So we're going to talk a bit here about moments. And a moment of a force is something that is really like a tendency to rotate. And it sounds weird, but that's really what it is. The idea is like torque. So kind of like torque. Well, not kind of like torque, exactly like torque. Is the same thing as torque, is the same thing as moment. So the idea is, you know, if I have like a little bolt or something and I've got a wrench. I don't know how that's supposed to be a wrench, but if I've got a wrench, like an angry chicken, if I'm going to throw a force down, is it better if I can only push with, you know, a force of, you know, 10 pounds? Is it better to put the force here, or is it better to put the force here if I'm trying to get it to rotate? Now, if you've spent any amount of time with this, you're going to say that I'd rather do this because it's going to rotate more because I've got a longer arm. So if you took this in physics or saw this some time in physics, you might have called this a moment arm. But the idea would be, you know, if this over here was, say, 10 inches, then the torque provided by that force, or the moment provided by that force, would be 10. Let's make this number something a little bit different. Let's make it like 15 inches. Then the torque would be 10 times 15, which is the force times the length between where the force is applied and what you're applying it to. So the torque here would be 150 inch-pounds. I guess I'll go ahead and call it feet. Sorry, this is what you get for free lectures. It's all crazy. 150 foot-pounds would be 150 foot-pounds of torque. Here, if I'm, say, pushing on it here, but this distance is only, say, 5, then the torque provided by this guy, thank you, the torque provided by this guy would be 10 times 5, or 50 foot-pounds. Okay, so the idea is that if I'm trying to apply a force to cause a rotation, the further away I am, the better off I am. Now, we've kind of glossed over this a little bit in that I just assumed that I was pushing straight down on the force, or on the straight down on the wrench, you know, like this. So we have little right angles there. And the argument would be, well, what if I pushed like this? Which is more effective? If I'm going to do 10 pounds, is it better to do 10 pounds straight down, or is it better to do 10 pounds at an angle? Now, again, if you have any experience at all with any of this, you're going to say, well, it's way better to push straight down. Well, why? Well, because it turns out that whenever you are creating torque, or whenever you're creating a moment about something, that, say, I'm going to push here. If I push down here at exactly 10 pounds, but if I can get one thing. If I push here at 10 pounds, I get another thing. So say I decide I'm going to push down at, say 30 degrees. Well, actually, the only part of that force that's actually pushing, if I think about how this would break down, this is going to break down into two components if I break this down. So let me move him out of the way. Okay, so if I push down at 10 like that, really what I'm doing is I'm pushing left at, that would be 5 square root of 3, and pushing down at 5. You kind of see that? So I've just broken down my 10-pound force. I've said 10 pounds here, and then I've got my triangle at 30 degrees. And then opposite, since this is a 1, 2 square root of 3 triangle, it'll be 5 and 5 square root of 3. But I need to go ahead and put this here because that's where the force is actually being applied. When you're looking at moments, it's really important where you actually apply the force. So I can say it's equivalent to going at an angle at 10 pounds. I can say I'm pushing down at 5 and I'm pushing left at 5 square root of 3. Now, that would be like pulling on the wrench. Now, obviously, maybe, hopefully, pulling on the wrench here, this actually does nothing. Does no rotation. Causes, let's say that. Causes no rotation. Right? Because as long as I'm pulling on it, I mean, it's not going to rotate because I'm pulling on it directly. And we're pretending our, because this is what you do, we're pretending our wrench is infinitesimally thin. So I'm actually, you know, right in the line of whatever with that. Now, whenever I'm pushing down here, though, that does cause rotation. Okay. So if I'm at a distance of, say, 7 feet, this is a gigantic wrench. If I'm at a distance of 7 feet, the moment caused by this force is going to be the 7 feet times 5 pounds. So this is only going to give me 35 foot-pounds of torque. Whereas if I had my wrench in the previous example, if I was, again, 7 feet away, then the moment caused by this would be 10 times 7, or 70 foot-pounds. So, and this should make sense from your practical experience that if you're trying to make something turn, you want to be tangent to it. And that's how you get the most bang for the buck, I guess, is that you maximize, I'll write that out, you maximize your torque, or moment, and you apply a force tangent to the rotation you want. Moment. Come on. Tangent to the moment. Okay. That doesn't mean you can't get moment the other way. It just means that it's not as powerful. Okay? So I've been kind of playing around with this and doing a little bit of hand waving, and I'm going to try to less hand wave as we go along. So now is a good time as any to introduce the idea of the right hand rule again. And the right hand rule is what we use to define, among other things, this is going to define positive and negative moments. It'll help us decide whether a moment is positive or negative. Actually, it helps us define, define the direction of the moment. Okay, so it helps us define the direction of the moment. So the idea is if I take this force and I go push on it, well, what's it going to try to do? I'm talking about this guy. If I push here, what's he going to do? You should say, well, he's going to go like that, right? That's the direction our, what's it called? It's going to go, our wrench is going to go around like that. Now, we actually define this as a positive moment. Okay, and the reason it's positive is stick your hand on your computer screen right now and curve your hand to where, like, this is your, you should use your right hand because it's a right hand rule. So this should be like the palm of your hand, and these should be your fingers. You have really weird looking fingers. And then your thumb is going to be sticking up right here where the screw is, or the bolt, or whatever that is. Okay, so your hand, your palm of your hand is here, and your fingers are curling around. And your thumb is sticking up, okay? That is why we call it a positive moment, because it's coming out of the page. So this would be like your z-axis. So if you consider this to be, you know, y, x, then z is coming out of the page. So we call things that come out of the page a positive moment. So we've had these labeled as plus 70, and that was actually by design. It was intentional, that this is actually a positive moment. So the idea is that if you want to do this, so you can, so put your hand, how do I want to say this? So put your, like, the what do you call that? The heel? Put your whatever part. The part that touches the paper when you write. Put your hand on the thing that's rotating. Or that you're, that's trying to rotate is probably a better way to say it. That you're trying to rotate. Then you point your fingers toward where the force is touching, or the force is being applied. Okay, so you point your fingers to where the force is being applied, and then you curl your fingers. No, I can spell, I swear. Fingers. Curl your fingers in the direction of the force. Okay? So try that again. So stick your hand on your screen, right where the little... So stick your hand right here. Okay? Now you got to point all four fingers this way. So point your fingers that way. And now because the force is pointing down, now you curl your fingers down. Okay, so point, curl, point, curl. And your thumb should be sticking up. Okay, so the moment is in the direction of your thumb. And this is why we call it the right hand rule. So you use your right hand, in case that's not obvious. If you use your left hand, it's going to be backwards. If you don't believe me, try it out. It's going to be actually probably pretty hard to do this picture with your left hand, because you're going to have to turn it upside down and it's going to hurt. So if you don't believe, go ahead and try it, because it's actually going to be a wonderful learning experience trying to do that with your left hand. You're going to go, oh, okay. And eventually, I mean, it's just the way I drew it. I drew it so it's easy to do with the right hand rule. I could draw you something that was easy or that was hard to do with the right hand rule. But we call coming out of the page positive, right? Because that's the positive z-axis. Something that's inside going into the page would be the negative z-axis. Now, what else we do is we, to make this easier in 2D, yes, this is easy, compared to where we're eventually going to be going with this. To make this easy in 2D, you see how this particular positive moment is going counterclockwise, right? Because when you're holding your fingers, if you're curling your fingers in the counterclockwise direction, your thumb is pointing out. So counterclockwise is considered to be positive moment in 2D. This is, because otherwise it doesn't really make any sense. I mean, I guess it does, but I don't like to think about, I don't want to try to do it by hand in 3D because it's just too much of a pain. So counterclockwise, it's considered to be a positive moment. And then clockwise, it's considered to be a negative moment. Okay, so you can try that. You know, try curling your fingers around this way. So you're, I don't know how that's a finger. I need a better way to draw. Finger. And now your thumb is actually pointing into the page, theoretically. Fingers, try it. your finger's going to be pointing to the page. So that's considered a negative moment. Now, you would get a negative moment if I reversed the direction of my force. So let's do this. What that was. Let's do this again. And if I apply a force down here, if I put my hand here, point in the direction where the force is being applied, and then curl my fingers in the direction of the force, now your thumb should be pointing in. So this is a negative moment. Okay, you can't spell. This is a negative moment. And it's, again, clockwise. So if this was basically the same thing where we had 10 pounds of force here, and it was, say, 7 feet away, we would say that the moment for this was negative 10 times 7. So foot pounds. I don't know why I'm writing over myself. That's kind of silly, isn't it? Chunk equals negative 70 foot pounds. Okay. And again, the idea is just to get you used to this, because we're going to pop this up into 3D in a bit, and then it's going to be even more fun. It's important also to recognize that in statics, or pretty much any engineering or physics, once you get past physics one, this isn't just plug and chug. I can't just give you a formula and you use it every time. Every single time that you solve a problem, you're actually going to have to think about it. And you can learn strategies that will help you figure out how to do it. But in general, it's not going to be just straightforward. You're going to actually have to mess with this. I will, however, give you a formula just because you're going to see it. So the magnitude, and again, this is magnitude, not direction. The magnitude of a moment is a vector, so you'll eventually have to attach direction to it. The magnitude of a moment is given by, and you'll see this equation all over the place, moment equals FD. Okay? So this is going to be the force, and this is the perpendicular distance between some point. So let me call this a moment about O. So a moment about O is the distance, is a perpendicular distance between O and the line of action of the force. Okay? So the idea is that, say I've got some kind of, this is me pretending to draw in 3D, I've got some kind of a, whatever, a point O here, and I've got a force coming out like this, a force coming out like this. If there is a perpendicular distance D, and there's my force, then the moment, now you put your hand at the O, put your fingers in the direction of D, curl them around F, your thumb should be sticking out of the page. And let me curl this way. So this is a lot of times how you're going to see it in your book. Kind of the idea is, you know, it's curling around that way. This is your moment. And the magnitude of it is FD. So if I wanted to write it as a vector, I could say it's FD in the positive k hat direction. Okay. If you want, so this is kind of a 3D, a pretend 3D view. Now, if I want to give you a top view, let's say it goes like this. Here's O. Here's my force F. Here's my distance D. It's perpendicular. And then I would usually just draw my moment like this and call that M0. Okay. So if you're looking at these in 3D and you see these curly arrows, that's what they're doing, is they're just trying to show that to you. Now, what else is important to notice here is that we said between O and the line of action of the force. So I just drew the circles in there to make it a little bit easier to see. But in fact, if I do this, right, this will make more sense. Maybe. All right. If I have a force, here's point O, and if I'm looking for a force that's down here, okay? The moment that's caused by that force, assuming there's contact, but the moment that's caused by that force about that point is not this distance, and it's, I mean, it can be, but we're not going to get into that. It's not this distance. What you want to look at is the perpendicular distance along the line of action. So what you want to do is you want to say, okay, if that's my force, this here is the line of action. So the force, the moment caused by force one, I would call that force 1 times that distance, and that distance there is perpendicular. Okay. So likewise, if I had a force coming up like this, F2, I'm not going to draw this one because that's not perpendicular. I want to draw the one that's going to be perpendicular to the line of action. So my moment about point 2 is going to be the force times the distance, but in this case, if you can tell, this thing is going to make it curve clockwise, so that means that this is actually a negative force, okay? So, I mean, you can get real straightforward ones that'll say, you know, you always love to have these beautiful problems that are beautifully lined up, and they're so perfect, and then there's my perpendicular distance, and it's labeled for me, and all is well and good. And so that moment, it's even positive, and that's great. But a lot of times you're going to end up in a situation like this one, where you've actually got to kind of draw out the force a little bit longer and see exactly where that thing is going to be perpendicular.